Hello, everyone. Welcome. Thank you, Mary, for that great presentation. And what I have to share tonight really picks up from all of the things that Mary just talked about. So the question that was presented to us was, somebody said, I don't understand the double rotation and I can't speed it up. How can I get this right? And I think this is a very common question that many people who experience this work or try this work have, which is how do all of those motions get minimized and go into speed? So just to provide some context, the reason for this question is based in part on the ability of the person to learn and also minimize properly a double rotation. This needs a highly qualified trained Taubman teacher to help facilitate this complex procedure. This is the goal, and good Taubman teachers may have unique ways to explain it and help accomplish this. So this is just my particular way about going about helping people do this. To understand this process, I would like to suggest the evolution of something. So if we take, for example, the evolution of ice to steam. So while remaining water, ice is first in a rock form. And then it melts and becomes liquid. And if you heat that liquid up, it turns to steam and it evaporates. This puts moisture into the atmosphere. And although we do not see the moisture, we can recognize its absence. We get dry, our eyes are irritated, etc. So this is partially true about rotation. The way it is first shown and experienced takes a journey in a process that has several iterations on its evolutionary pathway to speed. It is important to understand the following information. But more importantly, it is necessary to feel and experience this process to actually have the results. We know that the rotation is the only skill that we show in a slightly larger way than any of the other skills. And we know that it must be combined with all the other skills in the right way and in the right relative sizes to be successful. This lecture is assuming that the following information has been understood and learned and experienced. All the things Mary was talking about, proper sitting has to be achieved, the experience of the playing unit, the finger, the hand, and the forearm. This includes, as Mary was talking about, turning in one piece. The finger, hand, and arm have to be trained to move correctly in the rotational movements in both descending and ascending directions. Being free and connected to the back of the forearm is one of the most important points that any good Taubman teacher can make. Sometimes it's completely overlooked, but nothing will go well unless it is truly connected to the back of the arm and it's free. And free is a deliberate word, not relaxed, just free. So given all of that, and given that the rotation has been shown, what is the process of minimizing, of taking those larger motions and finding it their way into speed? So we can start with a simple concept of the timing. So the timing of the double rotation is very important. We have a preparatory motion that sends us into single rotation into the second note. We can't continue in that direction and then the subsequent notes would be off balance. So we have a new preparatory motion, which brings us into the third finger. That constitutes a double rotation. So now, what can help time that motion is a chant, swing, play, down. So if we begin with swing, swing, play, down, and we stop, and then we say swing, play, down for the next one, we've accomplished a double rotation. The movement has happened in the latter part of the chant. It's connected to the movement to the note that you're going to. Once you decide to go, it is felt as one continuous motion, even though it goes in two different directions. There's no stopping in between. So if somebody learns to rotate and they learn it by stopping in the preparatory motion, that will stop the process from going into speed right there. So timing is incorrect, if the person doesn't stay on the key long enough, then it creates a mistiming. And mistimings can create going kind of backwards into speed, meaning this way. So at this point, I want to say that the whole process of minimizing it is an important process, and one that is actually a very deep process. And I really encourage people to look into this, because very often it's not a question of just telling somebody, okay, that's the rotation, and you show it kind of large, and you just tell them, okay, make it smaller and go faster. Combine it with the other motions and go faster. It doesn't always work. If it works, I would consider the situation very lucky. So how do we begin to minimize the double rotation in the descending direction? So once I arrive on the four, what's important here is that we begin to work with the proportion of finger to arm. In other words, how it was maybe first shown was, now that you're on four, you would be rolling on four to get to three, and rolling on three to get to two. And the problem with that is that you no longer have any stability on the standing finger. And the other fingers also feel very much in the way. Particularly once you get to two, everything feels super crowded and just in the way. So what is the proper amount? So we know that the fingers have a movement. The hand and the forearm have the rotational movement. What's the proper amount of finger movement? You can move the fingers to the degree that you remain on the bottom of the key rested, and the finger doesn't isolate from the hand and the forearm. So one of the things that I always check with people in this moment is, are the fingers lifting to the ceiling? If the person says, yes, my fingers are lifting to the ceiling, that is the old technique. So what happens when the fingers lift is the hand that has been trained with these motions responds. So it's responding rotationally. So as I'm lifting my fingers, my hand and my forearm are coordinated with the lifting and dropping of the fingers. For teachers, I find it very helpful to actually say something very simple to people, but can clarify it in the moment, which is, I say to them, the fingers lift and drop, and the arm goes right and left. Lift and drop has to be felt at the same time as you coordinate with right and left. So lift and right is the same thing, and drop and left. Lift right, drop left. Lift right, drop left. And sometimes that clarification really, really helps somebody understand what's going on sort of biomechanically. Now, when I'm lifting those fingers, I absolutely have to make sure that the motion goes all the way to the forearm. But as the fingers are alivened and they're not working, they're not pulling, they're not over moving, they're just alive, it has to be connected to that rotational movement. But instantly, people will notice, oh, that's already smaller, because we have changed the proportion of finger to hand and forearm. So the degree of the movement in the main knuckle in one piece that still connects the finger to the hand and arm, and that the fingers do not lift to the ceiling. The moment the fingers lift to the ceiling, this whole procedure is ruined, actually. It won't work. And I recommend very much feeling this relationship of the how much the finger moves in proportion to the arm and the hand from one key to another. I highly recommend not just thinking, play it once with more finger, and then if it's fingery, play it with more arm, because that creates a kind of merry-go-round. So each week the student comes in, and one week it's too fingery, and you send them back with arm motions, and then the next week the arm is too big and you have to liven up the fingers. If the person really concentrates, they can feel this relationship of all the remaining fingers lifting in a coordinate way with the hand and forearm, so that nothing moves diametrically opposed to another. When the fingers are lifting, the hand is on the and forearm is on the right. When they're dropping, they're on the left. The fingers will feel alive, but rather close to the key. The object is not to lift the fingers as high as humanly possible, just to make sure that they're alive. So also, don't avoid the finger motion, as it will cause actually a fork in the road. Meaning, if the fingers move too much, you have two options here. Either the fingers become isolated or it causes the arm to once again be very big. You can begin to even suggest that the preparatory motion become a little bit smaller, traveling less far back, becomes the right size for whatever distance you are going. The standing finger becomes the balance for the lifting of the next set of fingers, like standing on one leg and moving the other leg. The standing finger has the following characteristics. So when we stand like this and I'm balanced on my right leg, I can freely move my left leg. I'm not using my right leg to make it look like my left leg is moving. There's a very big difference inside the body. This is the balance point, and I'm moving. So we're going to take the fourth finger as an example. The common thing, and what has been happened developmentally, is that there's been a rolling on four to get to three. The standing finger is what we call dead on the bottom. There's no active tilting. There's no pressing down. And there's no lifting off the bottom. It's merely a balance. So when we move, we're moving in a way that we don't disturb the balance of the standing finger. There is no sensation of movement on the standing finger when you make a double rotation. However, there is a sympathetic visible movement to the eye on the standing finger. So it's important not to freeze or tighten the standing finger. Terms we use are dead on the bottom or in total repose, but we don't use relaxed, because if you relax, nothing can move properly. You will begin to become very key sensitive. You'll begin to be aware of the playing of the key and less aware of the movement from one key to another. You will sense that you shift your sense to the feeling of arrival or landing on the next key. This sensation becomes closer to the feeling of adjustment, that I'm adjusting for each finger versus movement, taking it out of the world of big motion and imagining that it's the same motion, but a very slight adjustment. As the motions become internalized, the arm motions of the double rotation become basically invisible or nearly invisible. However, single rotations, say in a trill or in a birdie bass or a tremolo, although minimized some, can be somewhat visible, especially to the trained eye. Pitfalls to doing the timing incorrectly, not staying long enough and stopping completely on the double. One of the psychological things that I think comes into play is sometimes people are doing this and they're completely compliant and on board. They want to make the rotation smaller, but they're doing it wondering how would this feel fast. And in that moment that they're wondering how it feels fast, then the timing is no longer correct. Timing almost is just an exercise you do just for the purpose of doing it, makes you concentrate on it and makes it really right, and actually saves you a lot of time. Because if you have to come back week after week to correct the timing, you're losing time. Most people will begin the preparatory motion too soon. They'll go into the fourth finger again and begin and wait in the preparatory motion instead of really waiting on the bottom of the key. So use everything you can to help yourself. Use the chant, swing, play down. Look with your eyes to see that you've stopped. But ultimately, you have to sense everything, that everything comes to a halt, and you now assign the rotational movement to the remaining fingers, the hand and the forearm. Without the timing, remember, you'll play backwards in speed, and that's not going to be a very nice experience. This sets up a certain interaction of the single and double, which is responsible for producing the horizontal momentum needed for speed. And the reason I included this is because sometimes when people begin to minimize the double rotation, they stop the movement of the single rotation, and then they can't get into speed also. So you have to maintain the single rotation, which plays and immediately moves after the playing. So there isn't a stop on the single rotation. There's a moment of playing immediately followed by the motion. If we talk about the ascending direction, there are many things in terms of learning the rotation which are very important. And a few things that I will mention as reasons why it might not go into speed is if the rotation is not taught properly. For instance, if there isn't a little bit of an accommodation in the elbow, then the rotation never gets really connected fully to the arm. So in the learning process, as we rotate, the elbow lets go a little bit, allows for the turning of the forearm. If a person has a very tight upper arm, they might have to think about allowing the upper arm to come along. The important thing to know in teaching rotation in the ascending direction in the right hand is that the upper arm cannot be the initiator of this motion. So you can feel, if you put your arms by the side and you rotate, you can actually visibly see that there's a response in the upper arm. You have to allow that to happen. It's a very different experience to rotate from the upper arm. This is what we all kind of jokingly call the chicken wing. So we don't want to do that kind of motion because it's very disruptive. So although the upper arm has to be free, it is not an initiator of the motion. The important thing to realize is that this is also being combined with the in and out. So rotation alone will not do the whole job, and it certainly won't do the whole job of getting us into speed. So as you're minimizing the rotation, you're also making sure that you're still doing the proper in and out. This is a very good place to start to apply it to some passages. We usually take some 16th note passages and apply it to like scalar passages first, just to get the single and double and the in and out really correctly on it. By the time the person goes through maybe even one movement, the experience of that gets very deep into the body. So then what has to happen is that that has to then be combined with shaping. We can't get into speed without shaping motions. But I can tell you, in my personal opinion, if somebody learns to rotate and the motions are huge, and then somebody shows them how to shape on top of that, to me, it's like gasoline on a fire. So I try to avoid that at all costs. I think the rotation being done properly and minimized is a crucial step before just shaping. So when you shape, somehow the inclusion of another set of motions becomes this amazing division of labor where all the parts work perfectly together. So it further minimizes the rotation to the point where you don't really see it. You don't see it, and you barely feel anything other than the result of it, which is that the fingers, hand, and arm feel easy to put the keys down. All the things Mary was talking about, you have evenness, you have speed, and you have ease. So I hope that this was helpful in terms of putting some sort of framework around why double rotations won't work. There's work to be done to minimize it, and I really encourage people to, you know, take some lessons in minimizing the double with somebody highly trained that can help them through this process. Because the faster you go through the process of this, the more likely you're going to have amazing results. So thank you very much, and I will turn it over to John Bloomfield.